John's done a lot of work with us too, and I just want to reiterate what he said. I think, you know, the more we can sit there and talk to about something we hear or see, the better we become. I was lucky enough, I'm not sure how long ago it was now, to be invited to be part of a coaching accelerator course, which New Zealand High Sport ran, and Alex McKenzie ran it. And on that course we had a lot of other high-performing coaches, and it's probably the best time of coaching I've had. We didn't follow the curriculum as such, because we were the first group through, and Alex was brave enough and flexible enough just to let us spend time talking as coaches. And what we learned as a group was fascinating and allowed us to go back and be better coaches. So you've got a great opportunity here today. Over 500 people here, which is fantastic, not only for yourselves but for New Zealand. The other thing I'd like to reiterate too is the message that you got about the influence you have on our youth, and in my case, right up to the very top on our young men and women of New Zealand. Along with probably parents and teachers, you're the most influential people that will touch somebody else. And the better we can do that, the better our country's going to be. So I applaud you for that, and it's really, for that reason alone, it's worthy of trying to be the best coach you can be. And the last thing is from a national coach going down. Winning is important, doesn't matter what level, because your children know the score. But what's the most important is getting them to understand the process of how you win. So get them to forget about the outcome until the last whistle or whatever it is goes, and get them to understand that by doing certain things within the game, in that moment, they will win. And be really important, because we get guys who even get up to our level and they suffer in the scoreboard and they lose everything. So anyway, that's just a little bit for me. Start off, Johnny, go where you want.
Steve, you and your team have just lived through a really major achievement together. We'd like you to share with all of us how it feels, what you've been through.
Oh, it feels pretty great. look, me satisfaction is probably, you know, when we won in 2011, I was lucky enough to be there, and it was more of a sense of relief because, you know, we needed it, the country needed it, the team, rugby needed it. This time, we were going to try and do something no one else had ever done before, so we had a trapdoor we could jump out of if we failed. But, you know, it was a four-year plan. It was built around a very simple, aligned vision of trying to be, you know, the most, it's an aspiration really, not something that we would ever tell ourselves that we were, but an aspiration of trying to be the most dominant rugby team in the history of the game. And to do that, we had to play in a certain manner, and we had to do certain things that other teams hadn't done. So to sit there in the change of shed afterwards with a large group that had been there in 2012 when we first started, and the new guys that had come on board and picked it up, it was amazingly satisfying. You know, to be able to send off, you know, some of our greatest players ever on the overhead.
I know it's early days, Steve, but what are you already thinking about since the World Cup? And what do you feel you need to understand better going forward?
Well, most of the stuff I've been thinking about hasn't been rugby, funnily enough. But, you know, it still creeps in. You can't help yourself. And one of them is a feeling of excitement. You know, we've just lost five great players in Gore, Carter, Nonu, Tony Woodcock, Conrad Smith. And between those guys is 1,000 test matches, which is a hell of a lot of experience. But the excitement of being able to show the world and New Zealand that we can keep improving and keep getting better without those guys is something that I've been thinking about. Leadership, obviously, is something that I've been spending a bit of time. Obviously, I've got a pretty good idea who's going to be captain, because he's been here before, so keep it to yourself, it'll be Kieran Reid. but we need, I haven't told him yet, officially. We need a vice-captain as well. And we need to replace the five leaders out of our leadership group. We run a shared leadership model. So we need to bring five people into them. And how are we going to teach those guys to lead? Because it's not something that just happens naturally. Thinking about where we run again, the team is, whilst I'm the head coach, we've got three other guys in the group that have pulled a sweet spot. There's myself, Darren Shan, Gilbert Anka, and Ian Foster, and all our decisions go through those three guys themselves, so the four people we call the sweet spot. So redefining our roles, just making sure we've got that really rocking and everyone's doing what they're good at, rather than having them do things they're not good at. So we clunk, we want them to be doing the things that they're really good at, so we hum and sing, and we can do an even better job. So yeah, that's, and having a holiday is probably the other thing we're thinking about.
Sitting in this room, Steve, over 500 New Zealand coaches. You talked a bit about leadership. What are the three key learnings you've made about leadership that you'd like to share with me?
Well, there's a lot of important many, I think, but the critical ones, I feel, are self-awareness. You know, what type of leader do I want to be under pressure versus what type of leader am I actually under pressure? And I hear a lot of people talk about, I empower my people to do this, and then I watch them, and there's no empowerment going on, there's just total dictatorship. And that's cool, but you've got to acknowledge, if you're going to be a dictator, just say, I'm a dictator, that's what I'm doing. If you want to be an empowerer, then you have to allow people to make mistakes, you have to allow people to be able to go out there and do their thing. And yes, your job then as a head coach is to sort of sit over the top as like an umbrella and support them, and help them get through the tricky parts. But knowing yourself is the most important thing, I think. And then taking a deliberate action on growing yourself if you've got some failings, and you know, we've all got quite a plenty.
Want to share one?
Not really. I'll share one. I think the biggest failing I've got at times is I want to win everything. And particularly when I was a younger coach, I was pretty harsh on, you know, we'd give them a bit of banter, or it had to be me, it had to be my idea, and I wasn't, it inhibited me in my thinking, stopped me from being flexible in my thinking. But more importantly, it probably turned a lot of people off, and I probably knocked a lot of people's confidence because I'm reasonably sharp tongue and a bit of a bully when I was like that. So yeah, the biggest thing I had to learn was to sit on my hands and let people have their say, and I didn't have to be right all the time, even though I thought I was. It's irrelevant whether I'm right or wrong. It's more important to hear what the other people had to say.
So your other two leadership messages. First one is self-awareness.
Yeah, the second one is alignment. If there's more than one person in your team, be it you and the athlete, be it you and the staff and the athlete, or you and the staff and the athlete, you've got to have alignment. How are we going to live? What are the expectations? We don't have any rules in all that, so we have quite a few expectations. So what are our expectations? And I guess once you do that, you know, what's our vision? What are we trying to do? What are we trying to achieve? And how are we going to do that? My third one would be vulnerable. And it's really difficult to be vulnerable, particularly men. Male coaches find it very hard. But having the ability to be vulnerable and say, I don't know, being vulnerable and sharing things that that not many people get to hear in a safe environment will build an enormous amount of trust from your fellow coaches, management, and your athlete. So I think that's massive. And being vulnerable also shows that you've got some empathy. And empathy goes a long way in coaching. And I guess the last thing I think, and I've already touched on it, you don't have to know everything. sometimes we fall into the trap of, well, I've got to know this. Well, you don't. You've got to have a certain amount of knowledge, certainly. The further you are, you need more of it. But you don't have to know everything. What you do need to know is where to find the answers you don't have. But if you can turn around to your athlete or your fellow coaches, management, and say, well, I don't know the answer to that, but I'll find out. Well, I'm prepared to listen, you know the answer. Then I think you're well on the way to being a good leader.
Okay, for you to say about vulnerability, Steve, but how do tough players handle showing their vulnerability? Do players show their vulnerability as well?
Well, they won't initially, because if you don't show, why will they show?
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to lead the way by showing. It's okay, it's safe, and no one's going to take the mick out of you, and you do it on a one-on-one situation. And well, I try to watch my athletes every day. At some point, I'll just sit down and watch what they're doing. Breakfast is a good time for me. A, I enjoy breakfast, and B, so do they. So, just watch how they come in, how they go out, and then throughout the day, just keep watching them. And if you're there, if you mix with them enough, you know their moods, you know that something's a little different. And then it's just taking the time to find out, well, why is today? And in the course of that, they might struggle to be vulnerable and tell you, say, you know, you've got to be vulnerable enough to expose yourself a little bit. And then the trust thing comes in, and I'll tell you. And they'll be vulnerable, whether they're the strongest, toughest man in the world or not, they'll become vulnerable. Because we're all human beings, and, you know, there's things that go inside our minds that we don't have any control over. And we try and pretend that we don't feel pressure, but we all feel pressure, and we all feel things that happen. We all have emotions, and we all would like to have partners in this world and share things with them. And if you do, then there's going to be times when those things aren't great.
Vulnerability. How does that fit with a tough All Black? I've asked Steve if he can share an example of vulnerability in an All Black. Steve.
When we went to the World Cup and we were in London, and I had a few worries about a particular player, and he was exhibiting some behaviours that weren't the norm for him when he was really on his game, but they were the norm for him when he wasn't. So I got him to come and have a cup of tea with me, and he's just retired and most capped player in the world, so. You don't know who he is, ask somebody who's already. Anyway, I said to him, I said, mate, I've only got one worry about this World Cup. He goes, oh yeah, what's that? I said, you. And he said, really? And he's quite taken aback by it. I said, yeah. I said, you're the one guy that can cock this all up. We've been down a few rows again, so I can speak reasonably straight to him. And he said, well, why do you think that? And I said, because it means so much to you, and you're trying so hard, and you're trying to do everybody's better job, man. And I need you to trust me and let me do my job. I need you to trust your fellow players and let them do their job. And during the course of the conversation, he opened up and talked about things that were worrying him. And why he wasn't trusting certain things that were going on in the team. It all came back down to, without going into all the detail, it all came back down to what I said to him. It was about the outcome. He wanted it so badly, but he hadn't recognised it until I gave him the nudge. But he was brave enough to then come out and say, yeah, well, it does. I'll tell you another story too, because it's a little different, about a guy in Wales. And his name is Gareth Thomas, and he was the first gay rugby player ever to come out. And at the time, he wasn't out, he was in the closet. And anyway, he was behaving very, very poorly. He didn't want to conform. At the time, I was coaching Wales, had a massive drinking problem. And I'm pretty pretty sure a few of them had a few drug problems. So, anyway, Saturday, he's the best player, probably along the same with Bill Williams, probably the best athlete I've ever coached. Similar size, same body shape, probably not as pretty in the face. But similar athlete, anyway. And we sat down, we had this discussion, and then I let him. I said, right, you don't want to be a part of what we're trying to do here, you don't want to be part of all the change. And everyone looks at you as a leader, sure, I'm not the captain. So it doesn't matter, everyone looks at you as a leader in this group, so I'm going to have to let you go. I said, the door's open, but you have to change. So anyway, he left, and about 8 weeks later, I got a ring from his coach saying, well, he's changed. And I thought, bullshit. So I left it. I said, if he really means it, he rang back. So he did a couple of weeks later. He said, you haven't been to see him, and I'm telling you, he's a changed person. So I sent my assistant coach down to see him, a guy called Scott Johnson, who was a lot more empathetic than I was, had a lot more emotional intelligence than I did at that time. He comes back and says, yeah, you need to see him. And Alfie came back into the room, and I said, right, Alfie, I'm going to judge you from this so forth, but I need to hear you be vulnerable. And he opened up about a whole lot of things. He didn't open up about being gay at that point. It was another 2 years before he did that. But it was a remarkable story from a guy who was really struck. And amazingly, in 2004 we played the Lions, and you may remember a guy by the name of Driscoll got dumped and got all squealing and howled there. And he went home and they made Alfie the captain. And after the first test, Alfie came into his test jersey and he said, oh, look, this is not just because you're a Welsh coach and you helped me. He said, you saved a life. And I think, being able to show your own vulnerabilities, because I talked about some stories about my own upbringing with Alfie at that time, and straight away through that he began to trust me, and that was the change of our relationship. And it's a pretty good story, neat story really from a coaching point of view, and a neat story for him because he went on to become one of the most capped players ever for his country, and he's doing really, really well now. We're going to make a movie of him, so watch out for that.
We've been talking about leadership, and we've been talking about the keys to good leadership. Steve, what I'd like you to share with us now is, what puzzles you about leadership? What puzzles you most? What are your major areas of ignorance about leadership?
Well, if I knew the areas of ignorance, I wouldn't be ignorant, so I guess I'm still working on that one. But what continually puzzles me about leadership is the conundrum between leaders being born versus leaders being made. And I don't prescribe to the fact that leaders are born. I think everybody in this room is a leader. So yes, you're born, so from that point of view, yeah, we are born. That's about where it stops. Like everyone in the All Blacks that comes into the All Black environment, one of the first things I say to them is, you're a leader. And by leading, and by that statement, what I mean by leading is just doing your job, whether you're the baggage man, whether you're the new midfield back, is doing your job the best you can. And when you're here a bit longer, then we'll ask you to do some more there, and we'll help you grow. And it's the same, like, our children are born and they know nothing. But they learn soon that, if you put your hand on something hot, it's going to burn, they don't bother doing it anymore. So, they're learning. And they're leading themselves. And I guess life and work experience teach us to become the people we are. And that allows us to be either a better leader or maybe even a worse one if we succumb to some of the negative stuff that we have in our life. So hence why I think the most important thing about leadership is self-awareness. And then I looked at I look at things, well, what else do we need? And I say to myself, well, we need emotional intelligence. And the reason we need that is because when you look at emotional intelligence versus brains, you know, IQ, and I have got a big IQ, so I had to go the emotional intelligence way, is you don't, the person who can influence another person the most is not the brainiest person in the room, but the person with the most emotional intelligence, because he knows or she knows how to influence that person in a way that they will hear it. You know, emphasize it so they will hear it, so they will make the change. So that's massively important. You've got to have empathy because, you know, life's a busy place, and you've got to actually show that you care about the people that you're leading. Otherwise, they'll go like that under pressure. They'll crumble and they won't follow you. You know, you'll be out the front or out the back of, you know, the best leaders are usually at the back of the bus. But you'll be out there and you look around or you look ahead and there's no one in front of you. You've got to be, I've talked about vulnerable. One of the other things I think it's taught me, took me a long time to get this one, but I finally got there a few years back, is becoming flexible in your thinking. You know, what's working today might not be good enough tomorrow. And that's a real challenge for us sometimes as a coach because, you know, this is my idea. I've been waiting maybe 4 years to get this job and I've had this idea for about 10, so this is the idea I'm taking in here. And then you get in there and it's not working. And there's a number of ways you'll find it's not working. One where your athlete's not over the team. If you don't see that, you're in trouble. The results, so the outcome, which is important, as I said before, that's not happening. So if you're not flexible enough in your thinking, you're going to die. You've got to know something about what you've got. And if you, you know, the minister said that he took up coaching soccer and knew nothing about it, well, I'm sure you've got a book out and read something. And that's what it takes. You've got to get out of your comfort zone and learn things. And the other important thing I think about leadership is when you turn on and when you turn off. Because you can't be on the whole time. You go nuts. And the higher the pressure, the more nuts you're going to go. And one of my best mates in coaching just resigned today from South Africa, Monica Mayer, and he's on the whole time. And you can see him on, pretty obvious because he wears his heart in his sleeve, but you know, in the end it's worn down. And you know, you don't want to learn all those things about the coaching and then finally get there and then have to finish. So it's something that I've looked at a long time because I think leadership is what makes a difference. We're very fortunate to have a period where Richie was there. And look, in 2007 when we lost the World Cup and he was the captain, he wasn't a great leader. But he was only starting, it was only his second year. Hence why Kieran Reid's already been a captain 9 times in Test matches. I think Richie for a time got the World Cup and only done about 8 at most, probably less than that. But we hadn't helped, hadn't given any help at all. But between 2007 and he's just retired, now everyone's saying he's the greatest leader. So how did that happen if he was born? It happened because of his own experiences. It happened through work experiences, other people teaching. So that's the conundrum. I think we as coaches expect to be our leaders ourselves, and unless we get someone to help us, we won't grow. You have a lot of experience in life, but it doesn't mean to say it's learned. Some of us have the same experiences many, many, many times, and we still make the same mistake. Now, I'm a firm believer you're allowed to make the same mistake maybe once, maybe twice, but after that, you've got to get shut up again. Something's not going from there to there or wherever it's got to go, it's just not computing. So I think that's the conundrum that I'll probably with most of it.
Steve, where do you believe performance really comes from?
Well, I've always believed it comes from the same place. I've never shifted my opinion on this. I think Performance comes from motivated athletes who are living in, in an environment which is demands a high performance, high level of performance. And the job of the coach is to facilitate an environment which allows that to happen. And they facilitate it by making sure there's a right balance of stimulation and fun. So stimulation is learning. You know, athletes get off on learning, but they also need to enjoy what they do. And if something becomes a chore, and I'm thinking luxing, I'm thinking making beds, I'm thinking washing, and all those things that the woman in the room will do, and you blokes don't, apart from some of us, then you hear about it. It's a chore. And it's why you know, fun is really, really important. And if your other job as a coach is to make the complicated simple. So that's the technical side of it. But your environment is where it really starts. Your job is not to motivate the athlete. Your job is to inspire them through that environment of learning and fun to actually try and go somewhere else.
How do you get a large group of highly physical, strong-minded athletes to align, Steve? And how important is alignment in coaching teams and in the effective functioning of teams? Can you talk a bit about alignment?
Your alignment starts off like a little bit of like an avalanche, I reckon. It starts off with an idea, and the idea has to generate around a challenge or a vision. So when I first applied for the All Blacks job, I had a vision, and I put that vision in my presentation, and I think they thought I was cuckoo, because it was a pretty big vision, and it started off with us wanting to be the most dominant rugby side in the world in the history of Ghana, and then I showed them what I thought that looked like. Anyway, I must have impressed them enough to give me the job. So once you get the job as the coach, then you've got the daunting task of trying to convince the people that matter about your vision. And is it necessary that the vision stays the same way as you had it? No. What's most important is to have a robust discussion about it. So I started that with the management first and foremost. And I had one person say, well, why does it have to be so grand? Which was a great question. It was a great question because, well, why doesn't it? You know, we're the number one side in the world, so how do you make the number one side in the world get better? That was the answer to her question. And because you give those, and it was 15 people, who the opportunity to disagree with it, to challenge it, to change some of the words in it, and then at the end of it, right, are we committed to this, whatever this is? Yep. Okay, so now you own it. So it's gone from just me owning it to now the management owning it. And then we took it to, we have, a player shared leadership model, and we've got, from any time, 8 to 11 leaders in the group, depending on injuries or retirements. So I took it there and again explained the vision, and it was unchanged. And again, we had a robust discussion about it, but they didn't want to change it either. They loved it. And they thought, yeah, well, you know, particularly people like Dan Carter, he really, really got hooked on it, which was quite pleasing. Once you've got that group, the younger players then got the opportunity to talk about it. When we came together as a team, we named the team, and they got a chance to talk about it. But really, they just follow everyone else, because that's where they're at. But if they get the opportunity to A, disagree, and then commit to it, they still feel like they've been given an opportunity to say, well, actually, I don't agree with that, but everyone else does, so I'm in. Or they'll say, yeah, I agree with that, and I'm in. Or we'll change it. So you know, it's a little bit like the idea of an idea gets put on the table. And two things can happen. One, through robust discussion and allowing other people to tear that idea apart, it becomes a great idea, or B, you get rid of it. It stops you going down dead end roads. So the alignment, all, I guess what I'm coming around to say, is alignment comes from having robust discussions with everybody that need to be discussed it with. So your most experienced people in your team, if you're a coach with just one athlete, then that one athlete has to be involved. Because otherwise, you know, 2007 we thought we had alignment, but we didn't. That was one of the big learnings that, and I remember Graham saying to me one day, prior to the World Cup, we were playing somewhere in the state of England. We're in the box and he can't see from here to the other end of the wall. After that he can't see us, he's got to ask what's going on. And he gets very, he moves around. And anyway, this particular day he said, why isn't DC calling this move? Let's call it X. Why isn't he calling the move X? And I said, no, Graham. Well, is he calling it? I said, no, Graham, he's not. Anyway, that test goes by. Next test. Why isn't he calling move X here? I said, don't know, Graham. Probably a good place to call it. And he, what is he calling it? I said, no, Graham, he's not. And anyway, this went for three tests in a row. And the third test in a row, I actually got brave enough to tell him the answer. I should have told him the first time, really. I wasn't brave enough. He said, what? Is he calling that move? I said, no, Graham, he's not. He said, why the hell isn't he? I said, because he doesn't bloody believe in it. And he calls the move, so if he doesn't believe in it, he ain't going to call it. So it's never going to happen. So you can practice it as much as you like. We ain't doing it. And he looks across at me and he goes, why the hell didn't you tell me that 3 weeks ago? I said, because you wouldn't have bloody heard it. And from that, he ended up coming down from the great city of Auckland here and had dinner with Richie and DC and went right through our whole game and he came back, oh, there's a lot of things we're not aligned on. He said, oh, is that right, Graham?
It's all very well to talk about alignment and the importance of alignment, but see, how do you deal with resistors, people who resist alignment? How do you deal with them?
Again, you've got to expect it. There's going to be times that under pressure that, you know, the plan might not be working, so someone's going to come from the back seats and start doing a bit of whinging. So, as I said before, we don't have a lot of rules, but we have expectations. So, the key expectation we have around whinging is you whinge up. Okay, so it's okay to whinge, but you whinge up. You don't whinge across, because if I whinge across about something, I take John with me. So now there's two of us whinging. So we get rid of that. So you whinge up, and usually whinging up ends up at my door, which is good. So that's one thing. The other thing we do, we work off a model which has four pillars in effect. And the fifth pillar is about challenges. And for us, that's a big motivating factor. Or for anybody, for that matter. But for us, it seems to be really big. The bigger the challenge for us, the better our guys seem to like it. So understanding what is it you're trying to achieve with your challenge and where you're going with it. So if someone's not quite aligned, it's making sure that he or she understands that. Have they got that clear? Okay, and if they have, righto. The next thing, our number one pillar is our history. Now we often, you'll hear the All Blacks talking about our legacy. So that's about who are we, what's our identity. And our identity isn't made up of just this current All Blacks team. This team's been going for a long, long time. And there's a responsibility that comes with being an All Black, and that's you've got to win every test. And we've tried to grow that to the point that not only do we have to win every test, but we have to win playing, you know, attractive rugby, and they have to be good human beings off it. But I posed the question actually earlier this year about, well, who are we? What is our identity? And even with all the men in the room, we didn't really have that name. So we did an exercise that took everybody in the team, 52 people, were asked, okay, who are the people that epitomise what we think we should be. So using that process again and giving the person the opportunity to disagree and commit and educating. And then the I think it's about the fourth pillar in, is one we call inconvenient facts. You know, they're the things you don't want to talk about, but they're there but you don't want to talk about them. You know, the unsaid truths. So, okay, well, here's the inconvenient facts. So you get down to the nitty-gritty of why this particular person may not actually want to be aligned to what you're doing. So then if something comes out of that, you can fix it. And then after all of that, if you still haven't got them aligned, I guess the old adage, you can't change the man, you change the man. Because you can't have a dead soldier. That's like having a flat tire on your bike, it's hard work. So if they don't want to pump their tire up and come with us, get off the bus. So, but your job as a coach, so first and foremost, is see if you can change the man, or woman. But if they don't want to, then change and get someone else in that doesn't want to be there, doesn't want to live the way you live.
In what ways do you generate new thinking and innovation in your coaching?
Well, again, going back to those pillars, inconvenient facts are really important for us. What is it that we're getting away with? And I'll use an example, the breakdown. We were getting away with Blue Murder. We weren't putting anyone in the breakdown. And at that stage, prior to the tournament, no one was pinching the ball because they didn't think they could. But then Pocock and Hooper did us a great service in the Sydney test. They sold a lot of ball. So we had to admit to ourselves that we've got that quite right. So we came away and came up with a plan to sort those two out. And Checker and his wisdom didn't pick them to start the game, which he obviously doesn't like the Brisbane Cup. And anyway, they brought them on the second half, and we'd already got the plan sorted. I think we stumped on about 20 or something, 40 or 20. But throughout the tournament, Pocock was pinching ball in the World Cup, and he was the biggest threat. And the interesting thing was Pocock had 14 turnovers, and as a team, Australia had 34. And we had 59 turnovers, and Rico, I think, only had about six, and JK, we spread right across the team, so they weren't talking about us. But without rambling, the inconvenient facts of what are happening that you need to be honest with yourselves, even though you are winning, they'll make you become innovative. Looking at other sports, they'll teach you things. Our sports about catching, passing, running, space, and soccer's a great game for space. Those guys, if you see the real good guys, they're just one touch, bomb, balls over there. How the hell they see it, the space over there, I'm not sure. But we went and found out. And so we go, okay, well, let's learn that. Because our game's all about finding space. You either run into it, you either kick into it, or you pass into it. Then looking at other teams in your own sport. And the truth of the matter is, we aren't the best at everything we do. There's other teams out there that do some things the same as us. They do some things worse than us. But they certainly do some things better than us. So let's come and pinch what they've got. And not be too proud to say, well, actually, they're doing it better than us. I'm happy to have a look at that and give it a go. And then the other big thing I reckon that helps innovation is not being afraid to fail. Because being afraid to fail stops it, inhibits you from flexible thinking. You don't have to do it differently because we're winning. And it stops you from changing anything you do. And I think change is very good. In our situation, we've been the number one side now since we were number one before 2011, so I think we came number one in 2009 or 2008, and we're still number one. So how do you stay in front if you don't change things? Because everyone else is going to start doing, they're working extremely hard. So So having an approach that you're not frightened to change, I think, is massively important. And as I keep saying, flexible thinking is hugely important for that. You'll have some athletes who don't like it, particularly if they're from Christchurch, very conservative people. Crusader boys are probably the hardest guys in our group to change. And they just happen to be Carter, McCaw, Reed, Chuck and Sam Whitelock. Even though he's from the north, he's now become a Crusader, he doesn't want to change nothing either. So, you know, you've got to work away at those guys and get in. And trust is important. That's why I go back to the word trust. You know, if they trust you, then they'll give it a go. But be ready if it doesn't work, because I want to go back.
You've been through three Rugby World Cups, Steve, different experiences. What are the major leadership lessons you've learned from the three World Cups? How were they different? And what different learning did they deliver to you?
Well, actually, we went before, so I went with the head coach of Wales in 2003, pretty naive. Ted, well, Graham had been the coach, and we bugged off after being there 3 weeks, and I gave him the job. And I'd gone over there to learn off him, so it's like holding a verbal baby, and I probably got about 20 years' experience in 3 seasons there. It involved going to a World Cup, and I think, look, in no particular order, I'd say leadership is one key thing. You've got to have your leadership right, whether it's yourself, your management, and your team structure leadership dead right. You've got to make the right selections. And the tournament itself is reasonably unique. If you get injuries you replace anybody, that person who's replaced is out of the tournament for full time. So selections are important. Now, conditioning is massively important in any sport, but over the time I've learned that we can keep growing our conditioning, keep improving it throughout the tournament, particularly early on, because it's round robin. And in the round robin, all you have to do is obviously qualify first or second. And I think in the past we always felt we had to be first. And whilst that's good, you had a lifeline if you were second, you still got through it. So this recent World Cup, we worked extremely hard in the round robin. We had a reasonably light pool. So we played games, structured games, and that went for about 20 or 30 minutes, which were probably more brutal than some of the games we played in the tournament. To the point where some of the staff started to panic and think, shit, we've got to stop doing this. And I said, no, we've just got to stay true to the course, we'll be okay. If we do this now, we can button up later. And so conditioning was a big one. And the other one that was raised ahead this year that I found really, really interesting was all the guys kept saying, oh, you know, World Cups are different. And I found our younger players all of a sudden went from being really confident and sure about everything to being unsure because we're all going to something different. And we just feel, you know, ourselves being consumed, I guess, for want of a better word, with pressure. So I got Rico and Fozzie and Bert, who's our youngest sports guy, and I said, look, guys, I think we're going down the wrong path here, telling them it's different. I understand it's different and that it's, you know, it's a World Cup and everyone else wants to win it. But what's really different for us from a pressure point of view? To win the Rugby World Cup, we've got to win every game. So what's different? We've got to win every game anyway. Then we're out of World Cup. Everyone expects us to win by 20. If we don't win by 20, we're mates. He said, so what we're doing to the younger guys here is making them feel the pressure. But our big advantage is actually everyone has to come to do what we do every day. We swim in that pool every day. It's the one constant thing you have in the All Blacks is pressure. And we've learned to understand it, walk towards it, embrace it for what it is. So why don't we continue to do that? And thankfully the guys bought into that, they trusted me enough, and we went out with a different message, and all of a sudden you could see the younger guys who had never been to a World Cup before, and some of the guys that had, all of a sudden it was like taking a weight off their shoulders. And you know, we went out, and I think it's why we played the style that we played at. Previous World Cups, I think we've stifled what we're good at. But this time we managed to go out and play some good rugby. You know, the pool rugby, I know people weren't so sure, but we had a winning plan, and we didn't allow too much movement in our game plan in the round robin games, and plus a knackered anyway, because we played a game on Tuesday. But you know, I think those are the key things. That there's a lot of important many things. And this is one thing I know for sure about coaching. The most important thing you can do in your coaching, whether it's a team or an individual, is identify what are the critical few things that make the boat go faster. And there should only be about three or four of them. And spend 99% of your time getting those right. Get those right, all the important many things underneath that will come right. They'll just fall into place. Don't tell me how they do it, but they do. Trust me, they do. They fall into place, and your game is in good shape.
Steve, if you look at yourself as a leader in 2 years' time, what would you most like to see?
Swimmer. It's a lifetime project, man. I'd like to be able to see a bloke that was grateful for the opportunity to be given. Someone who cared about his athletes. Had done, you know, his country proud.
And if you were to hear other people you respect talking about your team, what would you most like to hear them saying about your team?
Oh, again, I'd want them to say, look, these guys are exceptional athletes and they can play rugby really well. But on top of that, you'd want them to say they're good people and that they've represented their team and their country in a way that makes them New Zealand proud of them.
Thanks for your time.